Greetings again today in the name of Jesus Christ, our wonderful Lord and Savior. Good to see you here in the house of the Lord today. It's a beautiful day in which to worship God in. We appreciate your presence. You'd almost have to be sick or providentially hinted or backslidden not to be in God's house today if you're saved. And it's good to see every one of you. We welcome the visitors. And to you that's listening out in the radio listening audience, we most certainly appreciate you tuning in to the Northside Baptist Church Hour today. Now we're coming to you live right from the auditorium here in Athens, Georgia. And this is Preacher Edward speaking. We're hoping during the hour coming up we can be a real inspiration to multitudes out in the radio listening audience. Take your Bible this morning and turn to Psalms chapter 92. Psalms chapter 92, page 645 in the original Scofield Reference Bible. Page 645. If you don't have the original Scofield Reference Bible, I have a few on hand. As I've said before, I'm not in the Bible selling business, but I caught a few along at a savings for benefit of those who'd like to have a Scofield Bible. I can save them some on it. I have a few on hand if you're thinking about Christmas time or something like that. And I'd like for you to write in and get some of our cassette tape. I could send you a list of more than 200 of our cassette tape. And they're $3 each, and the gift is used to help defray our radio expense. Well, many, many great sermons are listed, and you can write in and get a list or call for these sermons by tape or title. And then we have our brochure on our proposed Holy Land tour. I want to make mention of it briefly. We'd be glad to send you a brochure. Just write in and say, "Preach Edward, send me a brochure on your proposed Holy Land tour for next year." I know this hijacking and a lot of things like that's got a lot of people shaken up. But I think that's going to settle down somewhat. And if I go to the Holy Land next year, I'm going trusting God to see me there and back. And so I'm not uneasy about it myself. If you're interested, you just write in and we'll send you a brochure on our proposed Holy Land tour. I hope you're turning in your Bible to the book of Psalms, chapter 92. An elderly man met a friend he had not seen in a long time. He inquired, "How is your wife?" "She's in heaven," came the reply. "Oh, I'm sorry," apologized the man. Then realizing how this sounded, he blurted, "I mean, I'm glad." This sounded even worse. In desperation, he stuttered, I'm surprised. So you turn, will you please, to Psalms chapter 92, and we'll read a few verses of Scripture. Now I'm going to speak today on this thought, the Palm Tree Christian. And this is tape number 204. You can get the music, the singing, and the message on this cassette tape number 204. My mailing address is Virgil Edwards, P.O. Box 501, Athens, Georgia. 30603 is the zip code number. This is a faith ministry. We look to you that love God to work with us in getting out the gospel. I hope you'll pray for me and write to me. Now in the book of Psalms chapter 92, reading verses 12 through 15, the righteous shall flourish like the palm tree. He shall grow like a cedar in Lebanon. Those who be planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. They shall bring forth fruit in old age. They shall be fat and flourishing. To show that the Lord is upright, he is my rock. There's no unrighteousness in him. Now, if you notice, it tells you here in verse 12, the righteous shall flourish like the palm tree. Now, we find in Exodus chapter 15 and verse 27, it says, and they came to Elam, where were 12 wells of water and 80 and the right kind of person that's serving God. We'll make this comparison, and I hope you follow me closely in the Word of God. I'll give you several comparisons from the Scriptures today. Number one, a palm tree requires moist and fertile soil. Now, in order for a palm tree to grow, it must be moisture, and it must be some fertile soil there to cause that palm tree to grow. And it says in Exodus chapter 15, verse 27, there were 12 wells of water at this special locality. And there, of course, were many palm trees there, the Bible tells us. 70 and 10. That is 70 palm trees and 12 wells of water. Now the number 12 and the number 70 in the Bible is not without great significance. Isn't it marvelous and wonderful that out there in that desert that God planted 70 palm trees and let them grow up tall and strong? And around those palm trees, in between them, there were 12 wells of water. Isn't that something? And so a palm tree requires moist and fertile soil. Now for a Christian to grow or to survive, he too must be fed upon the water of God's word, the bread of God's word, and the meat of God's word. And if you have a church that's real fertile in this respect, then the faster you'll grow. A church where the word of God is preached, where it's believed, where it's taught, where people pray, where they witness, then you as a Christian grow stronger more rapidly according to the Bible and experience. We know that. Now they grow in the desert, but their roots go deep down into the earth. It's a desert land where you find these palm trees, but those roots keep penetrating, moving right on down into the earth, going down, down, down. You'll find in the Bible some outstanding men of God that lived in a desert, so to speak, in comparison with other surroundings and God's people, and yet they took deep root into the Christian realm in the matter of serving God and grew tall in the work of God. That was Enoch, for instance. Back in the book of Genesis, you have a man by the name of Enoch, and Enoch walked with God. He walked with God back in a day when they didn't have churches, did not have a complete Bible, did not have many people that knew God, and yet this man grew tall and strong in the service of God. Then you have Joseph down in Egypt. Now just any man could not have taken what Joseph did in Egypt. Joseph was sold by his brethren, sent down into Egypt, put into prison, lied on, and there suffered in Egypt for many years. And yet he grew tall and strong. He became the prime minister of that land. And everything was turned over to him to operate the country there in the land of Egypt. And you find others, Daniel in Babylon. You find as you move through the Bible, outstanding men, which would be a type of the palm tree standing alone in a desert, as it were. They're growing tall and putting its roots deeper into the ground and being some service while it's standing. You don't find too many today. You don't find too many great statesmen today like we have had in days gone by in America. Strong men. Men that stood on conviction, men that believe something and would not be pushed around or bought over, bribed. You don't find too many like that today, real, genuine men. Secondly, a palm tree is a straight and upright tree. In Jeremiah chapter 10 and verse 5, says they are upright as a palm tree. Now God wants his people to be upright people, straight, upright, honest, and people that can be relied on, depended on. Now, God called the Jewish people in Deuteronomy chapter 32 and verse 5, he called them a crooked generation. They so disobeyed God until God said, you are a crooked generation. Now, God wants his people to be upright, want them to be straight, and want them to serve him faithfully. Now, Satan was called a crooked serpent. Now, in Isaiah chapter 27 and verse 1, the devil is called a crooked serpent. Now, Christians ought to be straight people, upright people, honest people, people that you would not single out as somebody that's being crooked. I know you have a lot of crooked people in the world, some so crooked they have to screw their britches on when they get up every morning. Then you have some so crooked you can put them in a barrel of fish hooks and pull them out. They'll never get stuck by one fish hook. But, beloved, God wants his people to be upright. God wants them to be straight and honest. Be honest with God, be honest with yourself, and be honest with your fellow man. Now your word should be your bond. My daddy always told me, he said, son, if you tell somebody something, then you tell them if you're going to do something or promise something, you be sure, and you do what you promise and do what you tell them, and be honest because your word is your bond. Well, I've always remembered that and tried to abide by that. You have some people today that look you straight in the eye and tell you a bald-faced lie and never think anything about it. Now, if you are not in the business world, it's bad out there in the business world. You talk to somebody that's having a house built, for instance, and you have to have maybe about 24 people, different people involved in building the house. And you can say, well, when you're coming to work on this project, he said, I'll see you tomorrow. About 2 weeks, you meet him somewhere, and you say, I thought you was coming 2 weeks ago. Well, he said, I'll see you next week. And they'll tell you all kind of lies to hold your business. And that's not only in the building and contracting business, that's in many kind of business places. You can call a business place today and want to buy something, and if they don't have it, they'll say, we're out today, we have it ordered, and it should be in next week. And they don't even have it ordered. They just tell you that so you won't buy it somewhere else, and you'll be calling and getting back in touch with them. Now, a lot of business today is run on lies and crookedness, and it should not be. Now, of all people in the land today that should be upright and straight like the palm tree, it ought to be the Christian, the man that served God. You have a lot of so-called church members today that's brought great reproach upon the cause of Jesus Christ because they won't do what they say, they won't pay their debts, they won't do what they ought to do, and it's brought a great reproach upon the cause of God, and it's a shame. And they give an account of it in the day of judgment. Now, even some preachers won't pay the just and unjust debts. And if they don't, they've turned out to be crooks and liars. And I don't care who they are. They can go in the pulpit every Sunday. But if they won't pay their just and honest debts and tell people they pay their bills and won't, they're a bunch of liars and crooks. Even if they do go in the pulpit, they need to get right with God. Now, God wants his people to be straight and honest and upright. Number three, a palm tree is a tall tree. In the Songs of Solomon, chapter 7, verse 7, this thy stature is like to a palm tree. Now, a palm tree will grow some 80 feet tall. Now, 80 feet is quite tall, you know, but there's some palm trees in the desert that'll grow 80 feet up in the air. Now, what we need today is some tall Christians, some Christian people that walk tall among this world, some Christian people that keep moving up toward heaven. The taller it goes, the higher it goes, then of course, more toward heaven it goes, straight up. I mind these three fellows trying to measure a pole, and two of them trying to hold the thing up, and one trying to climb up the pole to measure it from the ground up to the top, and they were holding the pole with all their might, about to let the thing fall over. And finally, the fellow got up to the top and trying to measure the pole. A man came along, he said to him, said, what are you fellows doing? Well, they said, we're trying to measure this pole. We want to see how, he said, you're trying to find out how long the pole is. He said, why don't you lay the thing down on the ground and just measure it on the ground instead of trying to hold it up and let somebody climb to the top to me. Oh, they said, we're not trying to find out how long it is. We're trying to find out how high the thing is. So you have a lot of people like that today. They don't know which end's up or which end's out or which end's down. Now, we need some people today that's honest and straight and upright and grow up straight like the palm tree. Now, the palm tree is a tree that stands straight and tall in spite of the weather and the weights. Now, it has evergreen, it's an evergreen tree, and the strong wind, and the stronger the wind, the hotter the sun, the firmer it stands. Now, this whole palm tree out there in the desert, and the wind blowing against it, sand blowing against it, and out there in the heat of the sun and the cold of the night. You know, yonder in the Middle East, it can be 80 or 90 degrees, 100 degrees sometimes in the daytime and frost that night. Did you know that? It can be 100 degrees in daytime and frost that night, yonder in the Middle East. These palm trees would stand out there in the heat of the day and in the frost at night. And yet they stood, and that wind blew against them. But the harder the wind blew and the more sand is blown against them, the stronger they became. They just kept shooting their roots down into the ground, and the more the wind blew, the deeper would go those roots, and the stronger would become that palm tree. Now, it should be that way in regard to Christians. The more you're tested and tried and pushed around and lied on and slandered and talked about and kicked about and misunderstood, the stronger you ought to be as a Christian. You can't let those things cause you to buckle under. Well, when the wind came and the sand came, that old palm tree just stood there like the rock of Gibraltar. Let her come. Didn't faze the palm tree. And when things come your way And it seemed like that it's hard on you and hard for you to take, to cope with. Remember that palm tree. It didn't blow over. It didn't fall over and the roots come out of the ground and lay on the ground. No, sir. It stood there. It stood there strong. And the more opposition you have, and the more criticism you have, the more misunderstanding you have, the more difficulties you face, the stronger you ought to be as a Christian. The Bible said God will not allow you to be tempted above that you're able, but will with that temptation make a way to escape for you. And so that palm tree, there stands the weather, weathers the storms, and the trials makes it stronger. The temperature, the winds, the storms makes it stronger. Why, you can go out here, even in America, in a place where the wind's been blowing the little trees around, and they're a lot tougher than those in the valley where the wind never hits them, because they've been blown around. And you as a Christian should be stronger and stronger as you face more and more criticism, opposition, temptations, or whatnot. Number five, the palm tree is a very useful tree. Now the Hindus reckon it had 360 uses. The Hindus said you can take the palm tree, it has 360 uses. It offers shelter to the weary. The Bible says in our text, in one of our scriptures, Exodus 15:27, and they came to Elam, where were 12 wells of water and 70 palm trees, and they encamped there by the waters. People came across that desert. They saw those 70 beautiful palm trees, those 12 wells of water, and people came through with their camels. They would let them tank up on the water, and they'd have water to drink and take their baths and sit under the shade of those palm trees. While they were very useful, those weary travelers, those Arabs and different ones in the Middle East and traveling across the desert sands would look forward to those palm trees. They really meant something. So a palm tree ought to be useful. We have a lot of church members today that's good for nothing. I'll tell you, if the average automobile had as many useless parts as the Baptist church have useless church members, the thing would even run downhill. And yet we need to realize God expects us to be useful in his service and carrying on for him in every way possible. And so we should be useful. No need of a church member never doing anything for God. Every born again believer can do something for God. You can pray. You can be faithful in attending your church. You can fill a pew. You can witness if you would. You could give of your means. You can do a lot of things for God. There's something that every born again believer can do for God, and each man has his own talent and ability, and God wants you to use it in whatever field it's in. And so that palm tree is useful. Its fruit refreshes the weary traveler. It has fruit on it. And those weary travelers that come by, they reach up on that palm tree, and they get that fruit off that palm tree, and they enjoy it. It's good for something. Can you be good for something toward others and let them feed on the word of God because of you? It points out the places of water. When they see palm trees, they say, look, palm trees, palm trees. There must be water there. And they head in that direction and they find water. God's children should point out the real places of worship. You ought to tell people about your church and say, we worship God there. We believe the Bible there. We'll tell you where it is. We want to see you there. If every church member would do that every week, you'd be surprised how quickly the building would fill up. Tell people every day about your church and want them to come with you and how to get to your church. You'd be surprised a lot of people would come if they were invited, if you'd tell them, if you thought they were welcome. But God's people work around them and go about and never invite them to God, never invite them to church, and they figure nobody cares anyway. And they go on their merry way, lost without God. Number six, a palm tree is a flourishing and singing tree. You know those trees sang? They do. In Psalms chapter 92 and verse 12, the righteous shall flourish like the palm tree. Now the leaves are 12 feet long and droop slightly in the end, and the wind makes music as it blows through those leaves. You can sit around those palm trees and that desert wind will come through those leaves and it'll make beautiful music going through those leaves. So that music is a blessing. Tired, weary traveling, tie his camel or turn his camel loose there, and that camel won't leave that water hole, and those palm trees, and he could just sit down and listen to that beautiful music coming through those leaves and take him a good nap and drink him some good water, eat him some good fruit off the palm tree, and then get with that camel and take off across the desert. Beloved, God's people ought to be a singing people. Now, I know we can't all of us do like our special singers. I'm a tenor singer myself, 10, 11, 12 times worse than anybody. But you could maybe do better than that. Sometimes I don't know whether I sing home base or first base or shortstop. But really, I can't sing, but you can. But the Lord likes to hear me sing. Even my wife don't care about hearing me sing. And my youngins, they'll leave the house. They start hearing me trying to sing. They got business on the outside. But the Lord likes to hear me, and sometimes I just sing for him. My wife don't listen to it. She didn't go out in the yard with the young'un and take the dog with her. I just go ahead and sing anyhow. Amen? Now, you can sing if you want to, whether you care a tune in a tin bucket or not. You can sing the glory of God. God's people ought to sing. If you can't sing, you ought to whistle. I'll pat your foot or something. Now, the Bible says, Ephesians chapter 5, verse 19, talking about Christian people, speaking to yourselves in psalms. That's the book of Psalms. Singing the psalms. They used to sing them a lot. We ought to be singing more of them today. Singing the psalms and hymns. Now the hymns are the old gospel hymns that you find in these songbooks. And then it says also spiritual songs. Now spiritual songs are not the psalms. They're not the hymns. They're the songs like the trio sings, or the ladies sing, or the duets, and so they're what you call the spiritual songs. And the Bible said you ought to sing your hymns, you ought to sing the psalms, and you ought to sing spiritual songs. And all three of them are welcome in the worship of God, and all three of them are biblical, according to Ephesians chapter 5, verse 19. You ought to take a look at that verse, and you that sing, and look at that verse and see what it says. There's three different kinds of singing for God's people today in the church. That is the psalms, that is the hymns, old-fashioned gospel hymns, and then there are the spiritual songs like your special singers sing. Now, you might like one better than the other, but some might like one better than the other. Other might like the other kind, but we ought to be understandable and pray and serve God and be considerate and sing all three of them. The psalms, the songs, the hymns, and the spiritual songs. All right. Number 7, it brings forth fruit in ripe old age. Now that palm tree, it gets old. It lives to be years, hundreds of years old. And the older that fruit becomes, that tree becomes, the sweeter the fruit is. That old tree has been standing there for years and years, and that fruit gets real sweet. And when they come there, they start looking for that older tree. You know, a lot of people get the idea whenever a man gets old, he ought to be kicked out of the service of God. A lot of people have an idea when a preacher grows old, you ought to get the song, "Get away, old man, get away." Somebody said one time a preacher got ready to leave, and they didn't like him much, and he got up and said, "Well, Jesus tells me to leave here today, and I'm going to leave the church." The choir director got up and said, "All right, children, let's stand up and sing, 'What a Friend We Have in Jesus.'" Well, a lot of people, you know, they take that idea, but older man becomes, the longer he stays in the ministry, the better he ought to be able to help God's people. He's been through it, he understands it, and he has experience and the knowledge he should have. Moses, he was 80 years old before he took over his first church. He took his first church when he was 80. And pastored that church for 40 years. They liked to run him crazy. He had millions in his church. And he had to stand between them and God a lot of times. Get God from killing them. But that old man, he stayed over there in Egypt 40 years. And went to the desert and stayed 40 years. And God said, "I want you to become the pastor of my people. Lead them out of Egypt." And he took care of them 40 years. And when the old man died, the Bible said he was just as strong as it ever been, his eyesight just as good as it ever been at the age of 120. God said, "I'm going to bury you." So God carried out the funeral and everything and buried Moses himself. Nobody knew where he's buried. But he was 80 years old when he started out. Now, older you become, The older you are, the better you ought to serve God, the more you ought to love God, and the more ability you ought to have in serving God. A lot of young people, you know, they look up at the pastor when he's going over the hill. They say, did he come out of the ark? Is that where you come from, out of the ark? Well, you shouldn't feel that way. The whiter the hair becomes, the more respect you should give him and listen to him, what he has to say. He's been along the way. He has a little knowledge, and he knows more about how to help you than some little squirt that's just out of the seminary. And so you need to realize that. We all learn as we move along. And when I said little squirt out of the seminary, I'm not talking about a real, true young man that's called of God. I'm talking about some little jaybird that his mama called, papa sent, cousin supported, and trained in the seminary to do a job as a profession, know nothing about God. That's what I mean by the squirt. I know that all young ministers that love God and called in the ministry, they have to start and grow and all of that. And my heart goes out to them today. But the older you get, the more fruit you should produce for God, the sweet it should be. A palm tree will start bearing fruit at the age of about 7 and will bear for 100 years. 100 years it'll bear fruit. If you live to be 100, you ought to be serving God at the age of 100. If God lets me live to be, however long he lets me live, I want to serve God till I die. No such thing as a God-called preacher retiring. He may retire from his church. I may retire someday from Northside, and I may not. But if I retire from here, then I'll refine, head off in another direction. I never retire till God calls me home. God didn't call me to retire. There's no discharge in the army of God. God calls a man and puts him in the army, stays there till he dies or the victory is won. All right. The Bible said the wicked are like the grass. The Bible says in Psalms 37, verse 1 and 2, fret not thyself because of evildoers, neither be thy envious against the works of iniquity, for they shall soon be cut down like the grass, and withered as a green herb. God said the wicked people are like the grass out there. They'll be cut down, trampled under, burned over. But he said, my people are like palm trees. They grow tall and strong, they produce the fruit. They live to be old and serving me, God said in the Bible. Then finally, its branches is an emblem of victory. In Revelation chapter 7, verse 9, after this I beheld, and lo, a great multitude which no man can number of all nations and kindreds and people and tongues stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes. And what they have in their hands in the book of Revelation over on the other side? Palm trees. They had the palms in their hands, leaves off the palm trees. And it speaks of victory. Now, dear people, we as God's palm tree Christians, the victory is ours. Let's fight the battle. Let's get the job done. We have the victory. We have the palm trees. One day on the other side, we'll see we've overcomers. And we have the palm trees. In 1 John chapter 5, verse 4, for whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world, and this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. And so we overcome the world. Thank God for the palm tree leaves. The palm trees will hold our hand when we get on the other side. You are a palm tree Christian. God wants you to act thusly. Back in the days of Dwight L. Moody, great man of God, powerhouse for God, going down to prison to preach in a prison in Chicago. Dwight L. Moody went to the governor, and he said, Governor, sir, said, I want to illustrate a point. I'm going down to preach to a prison full of convicted people, many of them murderers, and robbers, and thieves. And he said, I want to illustrate a point of salvation. He said, would you pardon one of those men and set him free, and then I'll use him as an example how God sets sinners free? The governor said, all right, if you make it all right with a warden, if he can select a man that he thinks that we can set free and be safe, we'll do so. Dwight L. Moody went down to the warden. He said, warden, sir, told him his story. He said, yes, sir, we have a man here who's a hardened criminal, but he's been here for years and years. Said, I feel sorry for him. Said, we'll set him free. Dwight L. Moody got up. He had the pardon in his hand for this gentleman. Dwight L. Moody got up and preached his sermon, and then he said, we're going to set some man free today. The governor's given him his pardon. The warden's right here. And this man is going to be set free. And when he's set free, he can go home and never come back here again. And said, that's what Jesus does for poor lost sinners. He sets them free. They don't have to be enslaved with the devil in the devil's prison. They're set free. And they call the man's name. And he sat there and stared at him like he didn't hear a thing. They called his name again. He just sat there. The warden went down, took him by the arm, brought him up there and said, "Sir, this is your pardon. Mr. Moody's brought it from the government, and you're a free man. You're a free man. You don't have to stay here any longer. You've been pardoned. This is your pardon." And so the man looked at it, and then the warden said, "All right, all other prisoners, go back to your cells." And when they went back to the cells, this man turned, went right back with them, and left his pardon there in Dwight L. Moody's hand. He'd been there so long, the pardon is for him, but he didn't seem to realize what it was all about. He could have been a free man, but he rejected his pardon. And that's the way sinners do God. Jesus Christ paid your pardon, and you won't get saved. You reject that pardon, and you reject that pardon, you go right back out in the world, and you'll soon end up in hell with all other lost people. Pardon is for every sinner that wants to be pardoned. Let's stand to our feet. Dear Father in heaven, I pray that you'll take the message and use it. Speak to every heart. Use the message. God, we are palm tree Christians, and help us to act accordingly. And our Father is a pardon for every lost man or woman that's not saved. And we pray today that somebody, as a result of this good hour, will come to know God. I pray in Christ's name. Amen. Amen. Now listen to me. Debbie's going to play on the organ as she plays. If you're here today and you need to get saved, or you need to come back to God, or you need to join this church and we receive members, you want to come by letter, by statement as a candidate for baptism, or if you want to come for any other reason, you may come while she plays softly and while we wait just a moment. Would you respond? I brought you the message God laid on my heart. Now it's up to you. Whether or not God is speaking to your heart, I don't. You're the only one who can do anything about it. And you have the opportune time to do it right now.